Good morning, church. I greet everyone in the name of Jesus Christ on this very special Sunday that we have with the fourth Sunday of Advent that we are in this day. A lot to look forward to. I just want to take a moment and share some things with you that you need to know, and also share a praise that we got word about this week as well. So a couple of things. For those of you who feel led by the Spirit to offer toys to the fire department, that toy drive is due today. So just an FYI on that, and we certainly want to continue to help in that way. Also, church, just another friendly pastoral reminder, Christmas Eve is next week. It will be here, and I'm very excited to say that we will have two worship services, one being at 11 a.m. and the other worship service at 5 p.m. We will have communion and candlelight. You will also be blessed with a 2020 Benton United Methodist Church ornament. So I'm very, very excited about that, one per household. So we will have that readily available for you come Christmas Eve. Also, just wanted to let you know, too, that Sunday, December 27th, and Sunday, January 3rd, we will only have one worship service at 10 a.m. So, wanted to make you aware of that. I've gotten several requests from church members to have a Methodist 101 refresher. We did a great Methodist study several years ago called Revival, and I'd like to bring that back. So as we begin in the new year of 2021, the online study for Wednesday evenings will be the study called Revival. So wanted to give you a heads up about that. A good Methodist refresher is always a good thing and a blessing as well. So church, the praise is this. We, the church, got a phone call from Cokesbury, which is our publishing house, and here's what they said. They said that they have been keeping their eyes on the Wednesday Bible studies that we have done the past couple of months, particularly the Sermon on the Mount study. They have taken note of this study and want to get this. Give us advanced copies of studies that have not come out yet, have not been published as of yet, so that we can continue to put seasonal studies out to the congregation and ultimately to the YouTube viewing world. So I'm very, very excited to say that we are, in a sense, a promoter and good advertisement for our publishing house, Cokesbury. They have taken note. And here's what they've also said, that the quality of these Bible studies really struck them, and they were very impressed with how they were done. So, on that note, let us give a big hand to Rachel Stoneman and Dan Garner, who put so much effort, so much talent into making these videos and making them available to our church. If you would, let's applaud their efforts. Thank you. That is a huge praise. And here's ultimately what Cokesbury is doing. They are taking note of those churches who have really stepped up during this pandemic to get Bible studies, book studies out to the viewing world, and they were very pleased. So I'm excited about this. We have advanced copies that we will share and do for the Lenten season and beyond. So we will continue to have a strong online presence in the church and for everyone else. Here's the last announcement that I want to make here. Folks, if you will look to your left, what is on that hospitality table there are some United Methodist Women cookbooks. And here's the thing, if you were looking for a wonderful stocking stuffer, there it is right there. And they are giving us a huge discount on these cookbooks. It is a deal, it is a bargain. So if you were looking for a great gift to give to a family member, a friend, a child who you will pour into the gift and the love for cooking, please consider getting a cookbook there. I know that it will bless the giver and the receiver there. So with all of that said, church, let us begin our time as we worship the Lord this morning. And what better way to be blessed this morning than by with the gift of music? So Hannah, I'm going to ask if you would please bless us with your gift this morning. Wow, that was exactly what we need this day as we begin our worship of the Lord. Church, allow me to do this. I want to pray for us as we begin this day on this fourth Sunday in Advent. O God, who is the most high Lord of all, you have a surprising preference for people who are small and humble and who expect everything from you. You chose Mary, the unassuming virgin from Nazareth, to become the mother of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through your Holy Spirit, make us aware of the poverty of our own hearts, that we may be open to you and welcome you. Be ready, like Mary, to serve you and your plans, and expect everything from you. Come to us, O God, and give yourself to us. And we ask this in the powerful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our salvation. In his name we pray. Amen. Church, I'm going to ask if you would to please stand for our opening hymn of praise. Thank you. Sandy, that was beautiful. Church, you may be seated. And I'm going to ask now if the Bartage family will please join me at the Advent wreath. In church, we are nearing oh so close to the birth of Jesus Christ. The whole season of Advent means this. It means a coming or an arrival. And Jesus Christ will do that very soon for each and every one of us. He will arrive once again. So Gordon and Mona will offer some liturgy for us this morning. And there is also a place for you and I to join as well. So Mona, if you would, ma'am.
Last Sunday, we lit the candle of hope, remembering the hope which comes in Christ. The candle of peace, remembering God's dream of a peaceful world. And the candle of joy, remembering the Spirit within us who brings us joy. Today, we light the fourth candle of Advent, the candle of love. Scripture tells us there is no fear in love, for perfect love casts out fear, from 1 John 4:18. God created this world in love, and this world will end in the love of God. God's love pervades all aspects of this life, from birth to death, pain to delight, strangers to lovers. God's love is there. We light this candle in love. On this day, we remember God is love.
We appreciate you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Folks, I'm going to ask if you would, let us stand now and affirm what we believe in the expression of love that we all know and believe in through the Trinity. It's a creed that has truly stood the test of time. It's the creed called the Apostles' Creed. Let us say that together now. Please join me. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Church, you may be seated. And as you do, the choir will bless us with a gift of music. But before they do that, I just want to invite you forward as they gift us momentarily. And come forward as the Spirit leads you to place your offering in the plate there. Also, church, if you will look to your left near the hospitality table, we also have our pledge cards for 2021 that helps us to forecast the work that we will do to the glory of God in Christ. So let me offer a word of prayer over us, over the music that we will be blessed with, and over our offering as well. Let us go to the Lord. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, O God, the arrival, Advent, the coming of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, He is on His way, Lord. And you know what, Lord? If we're just speaking honestly, we need Jesus Christ. We need the hope, we need the light, we need the love, oh God, that He magnifies in the hearts and minds and souls of every man, woman, and child now in 2020 as we bring a close to this year, now more than ever, oh God. I believe that for so many of us, oh God, this is the moment, Lord, that we need. The moment, oh God, in which your Son, the God-man, came to the earth, where heaven and earth came to be as one. Lord, that is truly something, Lord, that we can offer our praise unto. Lord, you are the giver. Lord, you are the creator. You are, Lord, the sustainer. Lord, so we need yet once again to be reminded of your grace that we know in Jesus Christ. Lord, may the birth of our Lord and Savior bless us ever so abundantly in this Christmas season, Lord. Bless this offering that will go unto your kingdom building and the work, Lord, that we are committed to be the hands and the feet of our Lord and Savior. In His name we pray. Amen.
Oh, Good morning. There's more. Somebody else is coming. It's not just us. Here comes Ty. Come on up. They were just all on the back row, so they had a long way to travel before they could get here. Good morning. How are you? Love your nutcracker dress. It's so pretty. Ooh, you're all sparkly. Oh, my goodness. It's so good to see all of you today. I'm glad you're here. So, for the past several weeks, we've been talking about symbols. Remember, a symbol is something that stands for something else, okay? What are some of the, okay, it's also the season of Advent, which is the time when we're preparing for the coming of Jesus. So what are some of the symbols that we have out in the church right now that we've talked about? Look around. What are some of the symbols we've added for Advent? Yes. The poinsettias, very good. Miss Rita told me that after we talked about poinsettias last week, all week long she has seen poinsettias everywhere she has been, and it made her think about the star and how it looks like the star in the sky when Jesus was born. What's something else we have that's special during Advent? We didn't just throw these decorations out here for no reason. They have a reason. What else do we have? Come on, there's one really big obvious one right here. What is that? A tree, okay? We don't just put the Christmas tree up because, hey, let's put up a Christmas tree. We put it up because it represents something about our faith, okay? Tell me a little bit about that. In the 13th century. Well, there you go. I'm glad I wasn't here then, but okay. So we did. We talked about holly and ivy, and we talked about the circle of the wreath being never-ending, like God is never-ending. This morning, we're going to talk about the last two things, and all of you can't see, but right here on the altar, do you see the manger? We've added the manger. And if you look right here, you can see we also have some ornaments that look like the manger, okay? So our scripture that goes along with the manger is from the book of Luke, chapter 2, verses 6 and 7. And this is what it says. And while they were there, the time came for her to be delivered. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. I know y'all have heard that story before. No place, no room, no room, no room in the inn. Well, this is what it says about the manger. The manger, or the creche, that's another word for it, and it's sitting there on the altar. How many of you have one of those at your house? Do some of you have those in the... Yeah, I think so. The manger or creche is placed as a reminder that Jesus was born in the humblest of locations. Because humankind could not make room in their heart to hold the Son of God, Jesus was born in the most modest beginning, has compassion on all of God's children from the humblest to the richest. So Jesus wasn't born in a hospital or in a five-star hotel. He was born in what they used back then for barns, and that was a cave. If you had animals and you wanted to keep your animals safe and you wanted a place for them to sleep and a place to feed them, you kept them in a cave, okay? And that cave was like what we have for barns now. And so when Joseph and Mary got to Bethlehem and they were looking for, you know, somewhere for them to stay and for Mary to have the baby, there wasn't a hospital available, there wasn't a hotel available, so they found this cave and they went in there. And Pastor Brad has visited what they believe may be the actual cave, and he said it's cold and damp. Now, do you like to sleep? I don't like to sleep where it's cold and damp. Do you? That'd be like sleeping in a tent in the rain. That wouldn't be very cool, okay? You love doing that. That's what, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Mom, okay. All right. So today we're also going to talk about the lights on our tree. Okay? We talked about our tree last week. This week we're going to talk about the lights on our tree. And I'm going to read to you from the book of John. What's John? That's the name of one of the books in the New Testament. Okay? And so listen, every time I say the word in your head, I want you to think Jesus. Okay? When John wrote this, and every time he said the word, he meant Jesus. So when I say the word, you're going to think Jesus. Good. You're with me. In the beginning was the word. What did you think? Jesus. That's right. And the word was with God. And the word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him. Yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of the blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. And the word, Jesus, girl, you got it on the nose, good for you, became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a father's only son, full of grace and truth. So, Jesus, the light of the world, is the reason we put the lights on our Christmas tree. You did not put lights on your tree. Did you really? No? Okay. Are there lights on your tree, Ty? Do you have any lights on your tree?
Yes.
Yes. Who has lights on their tree? Okay, good. We put the lights on the tree not because our house is too dark. We put them on there to remind us of Jesus, because Jesus is the light of the world. And so every time you see a tree with lights, and I see like four trees just right here in this room with lights on them, and you're going to go driving around and you're going to see trees, places, and your tree, every time you look at that tree with the lights on it, this is what I want you to think. Jesus brings light to the world. He brings healing to brokenness, and he brings peace to all who receive him. May our tree, arrayed in beauty and splendor, remind us of the life-giving cross of Jesus, that we may always rejoice in the new life that shines in our hearts. Okay? Yeah, I know y'all are counting trees, and I hope I didn't miscount. I think there are three over there. I was counting three over there. I know we can see two. Is that right, Miss Ashley? Is there another tree over there that we can't see? So there are three over there, and this one makes four, unless I've missed one that's somewhere else, and I wouldn't swear that one way or the other at this point. Okay, let's say a prayer, and then we're going to go upstairs, okay? Would you bow your heads and pray with me, please? Dear God, we are thankful that Jesus was born and laid in the manger. We are thankful for the many symbols that remind us of Jesus. As we see trees with lights, let that remind us of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Let's go upstairs.
Thank you. What a blessing. Thank you, Gap Band. You have done it again, and we are very, very appreciative of you and the gifts that God is using through you. So thanks be to God for that. Church, here's what I'd like to do. As we move into a time of prayer, I want to anchor ourselves in the Word of God. The text that I'm going to be using is from the first chapter of Luke, so I'm going to go there now. And as you hear these words, let us anchor ourselves in the grace and the almightiness of God. Please join me. Let's say these words responsibly. For the word of God will never fail. Mary responded, I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said about me come true. And then the angel left her. Amen and amen. Church, let us go to the Lord in prayer on this fourth Sunday in Advent. And as we do so, our theme this morning is finding miracles in the messiness of life. Merciful and patient God, how we must try your patience. We rush through the seasons of our lives as though we had a mighty schedule to keep. We plot out our days minute by minute, crowding each moment with tasks, stresses, and pressures. And we begin to notice the growing darkness and anxiety in our lives. We proclaim boldly each year that we will not let ourselves get so caught up in the pressures and demands. And yet, here we are, back in the same old trap of not enough time, not enough energy. The very plans we weave, in fact, become bonds which imprison us. Help us bind ourselves, Lord, to you, O loving God. Help us to, in fact, slow down and to reflect on the many ways in which you bless us. Let us, in fact, drink deeply of your peace. Remind us yet again of the most precious gift of all, the gift of a loving relationship between you, Lord, and your creation. May we cherish the people and the peaceful moments you offer to us as we lifted before you our joys and concerns. So lift our spirits to remember, Lord, that you are always with us, offering your healing touch and your compassionate care. Lord, help us to ultimately place our trust in you. For we ask this in the powerful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who gave us the Lord's Prayer, praying together now as the body of faith. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen and amen. Church, I am turning now to the Gospel of Luke, the first chapter, beginning with 26. I will read through the verse 38. I'm going to ask, out of respect for the good news of Jesus Christ, if you would please stand and hear our Lord's words this day. We ask God's blessing upon this, your word, O God, and the proclamation of it. The birth of Jesus foretold. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a village in Galilee, to a virgin named Mary. She was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. Gabriel appeared to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman. The Lord is with you." Confused and disturbed, Mary tried to think what the angel could mean. "Don't be frightened, Mary," the angel told her, "for God has decided to bless you. You will become pregnant and have a son, and you are to name him Jesus. He will be very great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever. His kingdom will never end." Mary asked the angel, "But how can I have a baby? I am a virgin." The angel replied, "The Holy Spirit came upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby born to you will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God. What's more, your relative Elizabeth has become pregnant in her old age. People used to say she was barren, but she's already in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God." Mary responded, "I am the Lord's servant, and I am willing to accept whatever he wants. May everything you have said come true." And then the angel left. This is the gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God. Amen and amen. Church, you may be seated. So, church, I have entitled the sermon for this day something that I believe appropriate and relevant for us all, and that is finding miracles in the messiness of life. Finding miracles in the messiness of life. You know, you think about it, and I don't normally do this, but I'm going to do this in this particular situation and speak for us all. You know, the year of 2020 has been messy, has it not? Messy in multiple ways. Messy for families, messy for relationships, messy, of course, due to this COVID virus, messy because we have lost loved ones because of this virus. It has disrupted and messed up work, life, home, school, you name it, okay? And this year has just been messy for each and every one of us. So as I was thinking about and praying about the scripture that would speak to me that I could preach this morning, this was one of the scriptures that came up in the lectionary text for this fourth Sunday in Advent. And here's the case that I want to make, okay? And then I want to back it up with the Word of God. And it's this, that yes, each and every one of us recognize that life in this year has been super messy, okay? For Mary, the mother of Jesus Christ, she finds herself in a messy situation, if you think about it, okay? And I want to go to the Word of God right now and explain myself and what I'm talking about. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick up with verse 27, and we'll put it on the screen for you to read from. So we have Mary, who was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. Gabriel appeared to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman, the Lord is with you." Now, here's the first part of what I'm going to call the messiness of the situation with Mary. Number one, she is visited by an angel. And Scripture gives us the name of this angel. So anytime in Scripture when a name is freely given, pay attention to it, okay? Because it's very, very important. So this angel, this messenger, comes to Mary. Now here's the thing that we need to know, okay? This is in fact out of the norm, okay? Now we know throughout Scripture that angels did appear to people, but it was not an everyday norm. So for the mere fact that an angel, a messenger named Gabriel, came to this lady, to this individual, okay, was out of the norm. She was going to, in fact, be set apart for a divine mission, but she doesn't know it yet, okay? So, as you can imagine, put yourself into Mary's shoes for a moment. What if you, in fact, were visited by a messenger of God, an angel, okay? I'm sure that you would, number one, be confused. You'd be, in fact, maybe a little in shock, a little in awe. You're like, "Lord, what is going on? I'm not visited by angels every day in real time." Wow. Would you, in fact, run toward the angel and say, "Angel, use me, please"? Or would you, in fact, run away because you're absolutely terrified and scared because it doesn't happen in the everyday? Put yourself there in Mary's shoes, okay? It's about to get messy, folks, okay? Let me pick up now with verse 29. And I love what the Scripture says here, okay? She's visited by this angel. And Scripture says this about how Mary is feeling in this moment. And I think this is a very human response. After Mary gets this news, what is it? She is confused and disturbed, the New Living Translation writes. Wouldn't you be too? Okay? Wouldn't you be too if the angel of the Lord named Gabriel visits you and tells you something absolutely extraordinary is about to happen to you and in your life, and because you are going to be the mother of what is going to happen, wow. Big news, epic news. This is powerful stuff, church. Confused and disturbed, Mary tried to think what the angel could mean. But it says, the Word of God, "Don't be afraid, Mary," the angel told her, "for you have found favor with God." Ah, there's some comfort there in the midst of this messiness. Hey, you will be the mother of the Lord and Savior for all humanity. Being the human that she is, she's in fact confused and disturbed. But God in His mightiness, you see, and we can see this throughout the Word of God, gives His people, His chosen,
the royal priesthood, Paul says, comfort and peace, you see, in the midst of what is being told to them. You have found favor with God. You will not, you will rather conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be very great and be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of the ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever, and his kingdom will never end. So that is the message that Mary is being given from the angel. Can you see her wills beginning to turn? Her mind, okay, is going all kinds of different places, as we too would be in all kinds of different directions at this point. Okay, here's what Mary says, and I think this is the natural human response. Mary asks the angel, but how can this happen? Why? Because I am a virgin. How can this miracle happen in all of this messiness? Now I want you to listen very closely to what the angel of the Lord then says. The angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby to be born will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God." Church, my point is this. Messy is messy, is it not? Life can be messy. Relationships can be messy. Work can be messy. Church can even be messy. Messy is messy. Life is messy. But I want you to hear me say this, and it says this in the Word of God, in the midst of one's messiness, know that God, in fact, can provide a miracle. In the midst of the messiness that Mary finds herself, doubting, confused, what happens? God says, "I'm going to bless you with Emmanuel, God with us, the Savior of the world. Believe in me because I believe in you." The best way that I can illustrate this is to put it in an everyday kind of way that speaks to us all. So I thought about that wonderful poem called Footprints in the Sand. You know what I'm talking about? Now, I want to offer a very personal testimony. My mother had a picture of the footprints of the sand in her room. So growing up, every time I went into my mother's room, bam, there it was on the wall. As a young child, I would glance at that day in and day out. It was obviously something that spoke to my mom and ministered to her heart. And as I grew up and as I began to understand the words that were printed on the paper and understood the words that were being offered to the reader, it began to minister to me. But it speaks a lot about the messiness in life, but it also speaks to the greatness, the goodness, and the almightiness of God. Let me explain. We have a man that's walking on the beach with God. And it's a beautiful morning. The sun is beginning to come up. It's a very peaceful setting. The man can hear the ocean as they are walking along. The birds are flying by. It's just an absolute picturesque setting. You see it and you hear it. Obviously, there's two sets of footprints, one belonging to the man, the other to God. And as this man is walking with God, he sees reflections popping up about his own life. He sees those moments in his life when it was absolutely good, and he was on the mountaintop, and he was giving thanks for those special God moments. But what was also coming up, popping up, were the bad moments in his life. The moments where he hurt, the moments where he was in pain, the moments where he was going through a dark night within his own soul. He was going through moments, church, listen to me, that were absolutely messy. Absolutely messy. And as he was seeing these images, he turned to God and he said, "Lord, as I look back on my own life, I see two sets of footprints. But I noticed that in the dark moments in my life when I was struggling, there was only one set of footprints." The man, being who he is, said, "Lord, why did you abandon me during those dark moments when I was struggling and hurting? Lord, why did you do that?" And here was God's response. God said, "In those moments, I did not leave you because I love you. And in fact, I will never forsake you." You see, in those dark moments in your life, that was the moment in which I carried you, you see. I carried you through your mess. I carried you through your darkness. I carried you through your trials and your struggles. I carried you when you even doubted yourself and me. I carried you. Church, on this fourth Sunday in Advent, I think it would help us all to acknowledge that as this year begins to close, the year of 2020, maybe it would be, in fact, spiritually helpful to offer unto God this prayer. "Lord, this has been a messy year. This has been a messy year for you, for me, and for us all. But you know what, Lord? I believe because you are who you are, and the Word of God backs that up, it was in those moments, now in hindsight, as I'm looking back in 2020, 8 months ago, and going through my own darkness, that I know beyond a shadow of a doubt now, Lord, that it was in those moments you were carrying me. And I thank you for that, Lord. I see that now, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for offering miracles in the midst of the mess." Now, how do we know, church, how do we know that God provides miracles in the mess? Church, all you have to do is go to the Word of God to back up that eternal truth. And let me end with this. You see, Mary was confused. Mary was disturbed by the news that the messenger, the angel, gave to her. But you know what? She needed the satisfaction of knowing that what this angel was saying, he was going to back up. So let me back it up with exactly what the angel says. Verse 37. How do we know that all of this is true, that God will provide miracles in the mess? Here's what it says, verse 37. For the word of God will never fail, church. Put your faith, put your trust in the word of God that will never fail, because he is the one who holds us in the palm of his hand as we go through life, go through the trials, go through the tribulations, go through the mess, but on the other side, he is there. And he holds us. Let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, we're thankful for your word. We're thankful, oh God, for the truth that it is, Lord. We're thankful, Lord, that even in the midst of many lies that the devil puts out there, in this life, in this world, into our ears, Lord. We need, Lord, your word to help to cut through it, to remove those lies, to remove the deceit that we are so often filled with, Lord, and to be filled always with your biblical truth, because it is eternal, Lord. It will always lead us, Lord, to salvation, the salvation that is in Jesus Christ, who is Emmanuel, God with us. Lord, life is messy. This year has been messy, but I pray, Lord, that even in the midst of the mess, we might be able to magnify, as Mary did, complete trust in you, because you carry us through it. And for that, Lord, we are a thankful people. Bless us and keep us. And we ask this in Jesus' holy and powerful name. Amen. Church, the invitation this morning is this. As we bring our worship service to a close, if there is a heavy burden on you that has just messed your life and your world up, I want you to know this. As the Holy Spirit leads you, you come to this chancel rail. This is a safe place for you to offer that to God. As pastor, I will be more than honored to pray with you. Also, if you would like to join Benton United Methodist Church or profess your faith in Jesus Christ, who is Lord and Savior, we want to celebrate that holy moment with you. Let us stand together as we sing the first Noel.
Keep it.
Amen. Church, let's give the Gap Band a big hand. Thank you, folks. Beautiful music, beautiful music. And you will hear some extraordinary music come Christmas Eve. So thank you, and we will be blessed. One last thing, church. I want to mention that we have cookbooks on the hospitality table. If you are looking for a wonderful stocking stuffer, we have a deal for you. Cookbooks are only $10. It is a wonderful gift that will bless a life. So know that. Let me offer a word of prayer for us as we go forth. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, we believe in you, O God, knowing and recognizing that, of course, life is messy. It can be messy. It has been messy, and it will continue to be messy. But I pray that in faith we know this, that you, Lord, are the giver of miracles, the miracle that is Jesus Christ, the miracle, O God, that is the church, the miracle that is the Holy Spirit working and moving and convicting and blessing. Lord Jesus, we have so much to look forward to as Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, is born in our hearts again. Glory, hallelujah. Amen.
Join in praising God.